Morning, everyone. It's nice to see you all here. Every year, this is an event that I look forward to. I know all my colleagues do as well. And it's particularly fun when we can invite and introduce you to one of our colleagues in Boston. I'm pleased to be able to welcome Kahn here today and offer a few words of introduction. Kay has been serving with me in the House of Representatives since 1995. She's elected from the 11th Middlesex District, which encompasses part of the city of Newton. It's a city where I grew up, actually, before moving to Western Mass, and she is my mother's state representative and does an outstanding job at that. So I want to thank her for that. One of the great things about serving in the legislature is that people come from all kinds of different backgrounds. Not only are we informed by the priorities in our districts, but what we have done before or during the time we're in the legislature, I think, helps to set priorities. And Kay has a very interesting background before serving in the legislature. She is a registered nurse and a clinical specialist focusing on mental health issues, and that has led her in the legislature to focus on those issues, where she's carved out a real critical leadership role in the House. In mental health and family and children's issues, and is sort of a go-to person for many of us. When we want to find out more about that, look to someone for leadership, we look to Kay. She's the founder of the legislature's Mental Health Caucus, which was the first of its kind in the nation, and that has been a resource for many of us who don't have the kind of background in these issues that she does. She's been a passionate advocate for all sorts of human services. I know she's focused a lot on incarcerated women's issues and has been a leader in the state in that, and many issues that come to us both in standalone legislation or in budgetary matters that deal with incarcerated women, that deal with children and families and mental health issues. Kay is always the first one in line advocating for those populations. And in the position I'm in as Vice Chair of the Ways and Means Committee in the House, and I deal with the budgets that affect those programs and those services, Kay is someone I see a lot during budget time every year. She is someone who walks around with her big notebook with all the different line items and budgetary priorities that she's developed in her committee and for herself personally, and doesn't let me forget that these programs deserve their fair shake in the state budget. She's a terrific advocate, so not only for her own district, for lots of issues statewide that impact our constituents, people here in Franklin County and across the Commonwealth, each and every day. She's going to tell you a bit about what her committee does. She is the chairwoman of the Committee on Children, Families, and Persons with Disabilities. It's a relatively new committee, I think formed within the past decade. Maybe you can go into that a bit more, but it's become a very important committee, a very busy committee in a relatively short amount of time. And that's in no small part due to the great leadership and the dedication, devotion to these issues that our guest today, Representative Kahn, has. So I'm pleased to introduce you to Kay. I look forward to what she has to offer for us, her insights, and her comments on this very great topic that you've chosen for this year's breakfast. So let me introduce Representative Kahn.
Oh. Good morning, everyone. It's delightful to be here. I have to say, I came out from Newton this morning. I left about 6:20, and it took an hour and 45 minutes, and it was such a beautiful drive. There was no traffic, hardly anything on the road, a few trucks, but it's so beautiful out here, really. It's a pleasure to come out, and I envy all of you who live in the most beautiful surroundings, and it was great to see the mountains as I was coming toward Greenfield. So I'm delighted, and I want to thank you for inviting me here this morning. I want to thank Stephen Kulik for that lovely introduction. That was very, very nice, and It's true, we work together very closely. He actually sits pretty close to me, so I have the advantage of being able to lean over and talk to him when I really need to. And I also want to recognize my colleagues, Senator Downing, Denise Andrews, Paul Mark, who are here. And you have really great people representing you. I just want to say that they are committed, work hard, are very, very helpful, and I very much enjoy working with them and will continue to use them as resources for me as well. So I'm here this morning to talk a little bit about, we heard about trauma and the importance of understanding that and what happens to children in particular if they experience trauma. But what I thought I'd concentrate on this morning is, this thing seems to be moving. I don't want it to fall off the stage. Sorry. So I just thought what I mean, the title of my talk is How Does the Legislature Respond to the Needs of Children and Families? And that's really so important, how we respond, how the providers, and I know many of you are providers, how we respond and how what can we do to really move people along, move kids in the right direction, and offer them services and the things that they need to break that chain, whatever it is, of trauma, and help children and families move to a better life, better situation. And so I'm going to just talk a little bit about that this morning. But I thought, before I do that, I thought I would talk a little bit about just the legislature, give you a bit of a civics lesson. So for those of you who don't know, we have 200 legislators who represent 351 cities and towns all across Massachusetts. There are 160 are state representatives and 40 are senators. And the state representatives represent about 40,000 individuals, and the state senators, I think it's around 150,000. And so we work together. We are a body that we very much work with the House works with the Senate, and the Senate works with the House. And I think you probably know that nothing really gets done officially. A bill doesn't get signed by the governor unless everybody is on the same page, or mostly everybody is on the same page. So there's a lot of work that goes into moving legislation forward. And our session, we have a two-year session, so when we come in, when we begin in January, we began in January of 2013. The major part of the session will be continuing until July 31st, 2014. And then people go back to their districts and either run for re-election or and continue the work. But the majority of the legislation, and particularly anything that's controversial, gets done in the first 18 months of the session. So we are kind of in the middle now, and so it's a very, very busy time. There are about 6,000 pieces of legislation that get filed for every session. These are, and they have to be filed through a state representative or a senator. And so January is a very busy time when people come forward and they ask you to file some legislation that really is of interest to them. It could be a group, it could be an individual, it could be advocates. And so we work very closely with our constituents, with the advocates, and we very much, I think, as legislators look forward to really improving our lives, improving the lives, and for me, I think what's so important is improving the lives of children and families. So I like to say that there are three things that legislators do when we're elected. We are very much responsible to our constituents, so we really like to get to know our constituents, understand what their needs are, try to help them if they need help from a state agency, for example. We're responsive to our communities, so our communities are looking for funding for education, for healthcare, for public safety, and so we work with our communities along those lines. And then the third thing we get to do is to affect public policy. So when we come into the legislature, we're generally assigned to committees. And there are many committees. I think there are about 25 to 30 different committees. We have healthcare committees. We have education committees. And as Representative Kulik mentioned, the Children and Families Committee which he was saying formed about 10 years ago. Actually, that committee was originally the Human Services and Elder Affairs Committee, which I started on actually when I came into the legislature. But it was a very big committee because it included elder affairs and it included mental health and substance abuse. So about 10 years ago, I think, it was divided up. So now we have a committee on elder affairs, we have a committee on mental health and substance abuse, and we have the committee on children, families, and persons with disabilities. So this committee, it's actually a big, broad committee, and we consider all matters that concern mental health, particularly with children, public health issues involving children, child nutrition, homelessness, homeless shelters, public welfare, handicapped children and adults, all sorts of developmental disabilities. And that's sort of the bulk of what we try to do. And we have many agencies that we sort of oversee. So we oversee the Department of Children and Families, the Department of Youth Services, the Department of Transitional Assistance, the Department of Developmental Disabilities, and we also work with the Commissions for the Blind and Deaf, Hard of Hearing, and the Mass Rehab Commission, as well as the Office of Refugees. We also work with the Child Advocates. So we have a very broad range of agencies that we oversee. And so you can imagine what I'm going to talk to you about this morning is just a snippet, I think, of what we get to do. But really, it's a great honor and a privilege to have this opportunity. And I have been honored to be the co-chair or the house chair of the committee for the last 5 years. So I've really, I think, come to have a greater understanding of what the needs are in our communities. And so it's wonderful to be out here, and I look forward to hearing from all of you about the local issues. And in fact, I just wanted to mention, on Monday, my committee is actually going out to Pittsfield, and we're having an oversight hearing with the Department of Children and Families, so if people want to know more about that, I'd be happy to share that information when we finish. So we, some of the things that we do on the committee, of course, is we get of the 6,000 bills that get filed, we get about 150 bills coming specifically to my committee, and these are all bills that have to do with Department of Transitional Assistance and all the departments that I mentioned. And so people have filed legislation to really make things better for our children and families and those who suffer from developmental disabilities and other problems. So we work very closely together. The House and the Senate work closely together. We have public hearings. So every single bill that gets filed in Massachusetts, close to 6,000, as I mentioned, they are all entitled to have a public hearing. And so the committees organize the public hearings around the bills that they receive. So we are in the middle right now, as is every committee, hearing the legislation that is before us. And there's a lot of, 150 bills, doesn't sound like much when you talk about 6,000, but it's actually quite a few bills. And so we try to organize ourselves so that people can come in, and we know that it's often hard for people to come in from Western Mass, and so that's why we're actually coming out to Pittsfield, because we think it's good to get around the state and hear what the needs are. So one of the things that's come before us, and I'm going to mention a few bills that I think there was an interest in hearing about, but one of the issues that is before our committee right now, and even before the legislature, and I know my colleagues have been very involved in this as well, and that is the whole issue around welfare. And we hear a lot about the issue of waste, fraud, and abuse. And so we've tried to figure out ways to reframe the dialogue, because we know, at least I feel, and I know many of my colleagues do, feel this way, and that is that how do we really take a look? Of course you want to make sure that there isn't waste, fraud, and abuse, but really how do we change the dialogue and begin to think about how we can really help people? How do we help people sort of change in their lives so that they can move forward to get the education they need, get the training they need, get their needs taken care of around daycare, transportation, and really help people begin to focus on moving out from the welfare situation, because we feel that most people don't really want to be on welfare. They really do want to get back into some sort of self-sustaining situation. So one of the bills that I filed with my colleague, Representative Tom Conroy, who was the chair of the Labor and Workforce Development Committee, together we filed a bill, House 114, called Pathways to Family Economic Self-Sufficiency. So this is, I feel, a very important piece of legislation, and it really is all, it's really set up to be sort of a pilot program that would equip low-income families for long-term economic stability and self-support, requiring that 40% of the participants be recipients of transitional aid to families with dependent children. And we feel that in this bill, I think some of the things that come up through this legislation, and it was really brought to me by the Crittenden Union, and they've done a lot of thinking around what's important and how do we move people forward. And so two things that I think are important in the legislation: there's an interest in sort of connecting more with the community colleges, and it's great to be out here and to be here in a community college, but I think we feel that so many of these folks have a high school diploma, if they're fortunate, or you know, many have less than a high school diploma. So we would really like to see people move out from under and get back to pursuing educational opportunities, because I think most all of you in the room understand that you can't really get a job that is going to allow you to be self-sustaining unless you have a college degree or some training or a certificate in areas that might be useful for future job work. And so it's getting the education that people need. And the other piece of it that I feel really strongly about is the case management system. Because I think it's, you know, it's difficult for people who haven't been working or have been out of the system for a long time, to feel confident to apply for a job, and B, to understand how they can look for daycare and how they can find the transportation that they might need even to get to the community college. And so we feel that the case management system is a really good system, because it allows people to get the support that they need to move out. And I also feel that on top of that, we have to be thinking about the employers as well, because many of the employers have not experienced people coming in that haven't had the job training. And so they need support as well. And I think it works better if we can think in terms of more of a case management system. So that's something that I think is very important. And what I have been sort of pushing for is to include this this type of legislation in our welfare reform, in our pursuit of welfare reform. So that's where I've been advocating, and I know many of my colleagues who are sitting here today have been advocating for the same thing. So it's more than, we don't want to be punishing people, we want to be pushing them out and helping them get out and get the education, the training, the support that they need around all of the things that go into leaving your family to get out and get a job and go through the whole process of education or gaining some sort of certificate. And I understand the community colleges have really stepped up, and so they're not just offering necessarily a degree, but they are also offering certificates. So people who want to learn in a particular area, maybe in the healthcare field, they can get the training and the certificate that they need that they can move out and move ahead. So we feel that this is a very important piece of legislation. Another piece of legislation that I think people were interested in is House 125. It's an act strengthening early support and education. And this bill would allow the Children's Trust Fund to collaborate with the Departments of Early Education and Care and Public Health to coordinate and deliver evidence-based and promising practice home visiting services to eligible families, pregnant women, infants, and children. So again, for those of you who are familiar with the Children's Trust Fund, this is the kind of work that they do. They do provide support for new parents, but this is taking it a bit further and having them work with the early education departments of early education and care and public health to make it a more substantive program and get more people out home into home visiting situations. Because again, I think it's all about support and really helping people feel confident, gain the confidence that they need or get the services they need to help them move forward. Another bill that I was just going to mention is House 160. It's an act to establish an Office of Youth Development. And this bill would create an Office of Youth Development at the Department of Public Health to implement pilot programs in Boston, New Bedford, Lawrence, Lowell, Holyoke, and Worcester for youth 7 to 18 years of age to promote positive social behaviors, provide work skills, and reduce violent behavior. These programs are to be available year-round, including weekends, at community health centers for children who are enrolled or not enrolled in school, as well as for those who no longer attend school. So I think this would be a very important piece of legislation, because the other side of this is that we really would like to keep kids who are at risk out of the criminal justice system and to really get them ready and to be able to understand what they need to do and we to understand what their needs are. And so to me, this makes sense, and this is a bill that's been heard on my committee. Another bill, Senate 52, actually, is an act to promote restorative justice practices. And this is legislation that would allow youth who have committed a sex offense or caused a domestic or family violence to request a court to approve their attending community-based restorative justice program. So again, you know, it's giving youth a second chance. It's really working with them, those who are at high risk, to change their behaviors and to work with them. And they would then work with a probation officer who would help move them forward, get them back in school. I mean, there are a whole host of things that we can do for youth. So that it really kind of goes along with the other bill. And this bill would actually also establish an advisory committee to track the use of community-based restorative programs and in juvenile and adult criminal proceedings, and again, to really pay attention to the youth who are at risk and to provide the supports and find the services that they need that to help make change. And again, many of these kids probably come from homes where they have experienced trauma in the past, and so we want to change the dynamic and see if we can move them in a different direction. House 151 is an act relative to real lives. This is a bill that is related to developmental folks with developmental disabilities, and again, it's an interesting bill. Actually, we in fact, I just met with the Department of Developmental Disabilities to talk about moving this bill forward. It's something that's been happening in other states, and one of the things that I think is unique about this is it offers. So I know myself when I've had constituents come to me, they have a child who's turning 22, who's eligible for a group home, and then it's up to the parents or the guardian to figure out what is the best situation for this child or young person, and it's a big commitment that you're making to have a person, have your family member or your loved one placed in a group home, and you feel like you're making a decision that will affect them for the rest of their lives. So this bill actually is going to allow families that, so if things don't work out in a particular group home over the years or if things change, it will allow families to make other choices, look for other opportunities. And so we're working on the details of that right now so that there isn't that sense, which I think can be very frightening for families when they feel like, what am I going to do? What if he doesn't like it here? And I've seen, what DDS does offer is generally they do offer families at least a few choices, so you can take your loved one and see what seems to work best at that time, but then you have the option in the future if things aren't working out. That's just a piece of the bill, but there's some, I think, other important pieces. So those are some bills that we've been working on that I think are interesting, important. And I just thought I'd take a minute to mention some other initiatives that we've been working on. For example, there's the JDAI. Some of you may be familiar with that. It's the juvenile detention alternative this is a bill that would allow kids who are coming into the criminal justice system to be evaluated and then hopefully not sent into the lockup, because we know that those who are in the lockup are much more difficult to be around, and so we would like to be able to send these kids to an alternative situation. So this has actually been in effect now for several years. It was a grant that came through the Annie E. Casey Foundation, and DYS actually has been doing this for several years. Some of you may know about it. And I think, again, what we do for the juvenile population is extremely important. And I have to say, I have been out to visit detention centers, and I'm very impressed with what DYS is now doing for young people. When you walk in and you see young people who are interested in looking good, when their family members come to visit and they put their pants between the two mattresses so they're pressed, and looking forward to having them come to visit on Thanksgiving. And one of the places we visited, they even have kids who are eligible to go outside training for marathons. And these are kids who've probably never experienced really very positive things in their lives, and to begin to feel good about themselves and what they can do, I think is truly important. And so I'm very impressed with what is actually happening in the Department of Youth Services, and I expect that will continue. And we've, as you know, as a committee, we've offered various workshops for legislators and staff, particularly with people who have developmental disabilities. We have been able to offer some forums where people can come in and learn about the Social Security benefits that they might be eligible for, or employment rights, housing, issues in around special education. So we really try to be open to our colleagues and to also to people who are dealing with these kinds of issues. And I think it's great that we have the Disability Law Center, for example. They put on a whole program and offered many of these much information about all of these issues that parents and families and guardians have about what do we do now, or particularly with the turning 22 population. I mean, that's a huge situation that we have to deal with, and so many families are sort of not sure, you know, how do we go, where do we go from here? Then we also recently just passed legislation, which I'm very excited about. I was one of the sponsors of the legislation, the House sponsor, and it was a bill to expand juvenile jurisdiction. And I'm not sure if you've all heard about this, but what we did was we raised the age for juveniles. So until September, a juvenile who came into the juvenile system or the criminal justice system that was 17 was considered an adult, and went into the adult system, into the adult jails, prisons, and was really around folks who are much more difficult to be around, and sets them on a path to learn about things that they shouldn't be doing. And so, in fact, the federal government passed an act called PREA, the Prison Rape Elimination Act, and that was to then, if we weren't going to pass this bill and we were one of five or six states left that hadn't done it, they would have to provide a space that was away from any of the rest of the population, which was going to be extraordinarily expensive. I'm getting to the end of my time, and I'll just mention a couple more things, and that is, you know, as Stephen Kulik mentioned, I'm very interested in the whole issue around incarcerated women and what happens to the children, and these are the children that often feel the trauma of losing a parent. And so I've had many pieces of legislation and many suggestions that I've made that it's difficult to get them to go anywhere, but we're still working at it and have been doing that for a long time. So I just would end by saying that it's important to be involved, so I think it's great that you are here this morning. And I encourage you to stay in touch with your own legislators. And if your legislator isn't here, you should make a call and educate them. And, you know, we really want to learn from all of you. So because what we don't make up this stuff, we really hear and listen to our constituents and many of the advocacy groups that are out there. And then we can take it and lobby on behalf of your need or your issue and work with the administration or with the judicial system and see if we can move things forward. And I can just tell you that moving this bill to raise the age was a huge effort with the administration and with the judicial system, as well as my colleagues. So it's everybody working together for the betterment of all. So again, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm happy to take questions later when there's that time. And again, thank you for being here this morning. And again, this is just a snippet, so hope it was informative. Thank you.